Today we're going to talk about how to install the Klipper firmware or build it on the BigTreeTech Manta E3EZ. So basically, I've already got it powered up per my last install, which is going to be in the upper right hand corner. You can see how to install the actual operating system for the CB2. Now, if you've already installed it on the CB1, it's a similar process. So what you need to know is that loading your MCU is actually going to be when it's off over here. But for now, we're just going to set it up. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab the SD card, place it in the SD card reader, and place it in the computer. Next, what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go over to the webpage on the desktop for BigTreeTech. And if you want to search on it, what you can do is you can type Manta and it'll bring you right to it. So inside here, obviously you have your user manual, and then over here you have issues that you can look up. But for now, we don't really need a lot of this except for in the firmware folder. Now, the EZ bootloader, this, I'm not sure what it is. It's a little small when I downloaded it. I haven't tried it out. But the actual Manta configuration file for Klipper is located right here. So this part's going to be real important that you understand right here. But let me show you how it's done. So we're going to go over to here. We're going to go to the installation part. So under this folder for install and configuration, you're going to click install, and down here we're going to need to copy this part right here. Then we're going to go over to TeraTerm, and in my previous tutorial I covered how to do this, so I'm going to go OK, then I'm going to say continue, then I'm going to put in the password, which in this case is BIQU, and the passphrase, or excuse me, the username and then the passphrase, which is the password, is BIQU again. And then you're going to click OK. This will then log you in. Then you can right click and you can paste what you copied and hit enter. And this will bring you into the configuration menu. So now you hit spacebar because you want to enable low level configuration. We're going to go down to the microcontroller and right arrow with the arrow buttons. Then we're going to arrow down to STM32 and hit spacebar. Now we're going to have to figure out what the processor is. In this case, it's an STM32G0B1, I believe. But we can check that by going over to the website over here. And we can check inside the actual manual, which is right here. And it should say within the first couple pages what the processor is. So if it doesn't, in this case it doesn't, we can look on the board for the MCU. It should say G0 something, but we can also do it in Marlin by clicking on our actual, let me minimize this here because I was experimenting. We're going to go to the Marlin folder, the source folder, the core folder, then boards.h. And if you search for your Manta, you can see that the E3EZ is actually STM32G0B1RE. So that's another way you can check against what it is. It may change in the future, which has happened with other boards, but in this case we now know what it is for this particular instance. We can also check over here. If we click on that right over there and then go to configuration, we can check it in here, and if there's only one, then we're good. So you're going to find your board version. In this case, it's the STM32 for the Manta E3EZ. So we'll click on this, and you can read it right here. So the processor, in this case, is STM32 G0B1. So we've confirmed it in several places, but there may be other files, such as in the case of, for instance, the octopus has several different ones. So what we need to do here is right arrow, down arrow to the actual type of processor, hit the space bar, and these should be populated for you. If not, you can always populate them yourself, but they'll match the file that we just looked at. And we're going to be using the USB, so we're going to leave everything the same. So we'll hit the escape button on your keyboard, then we'll hit the Y button for yes. Now to build this, we'll type make, and that's actually in the directions as well, so I'll hit enter. And then you can go over here and you can actually check those directions if you want. Let me just back arrow here to get to it. So down here, after we've actually done the install, you can see this part, then it says make in the directions. So we can check on it now. And what we're waiting for is it to say clipper.elf. Then it's going to say clipper.bin, which is the binary file. It's being linked right now. So that means putting all the files together. So to see it, what you can do is you can click on FileZilla. And to connect to it, in this case, I'm going to use the same IP. So 192.168.1.7. Password or username, excuse me, is BIQU. Then BIQU. And then the port in this case is port 22. So then we'll click Quick Connect. We'll say OK. And you'll search for the Klipper file folder. Click on it. Then you'll go to the Out folder. And you can see that it's right here. So we're going to drag this across to our Downloads folder over here. Now I already have one, so I'm going to overwrite it. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to my Downloads folder, and inside my Downloads folder you can see it right here. So we're going to send it to the G drive. Now keep in mind the G drive currently is formatted as FAT32, or in this case FAT, pardon me. So you can do FAT32, but I recommend FAT, it's more stable. And what we'll do is we'll go back over here and right click and we'll send it to the drive. So now it'll be over here. I'm going to rename this firmware.bin. Now, if it doesn't load the first time, you can always add a second file called firmware.cur, and then it should have no trouble. But today I actually did have trouble. Apparently I had a bad SD card, so I had to swap it. So in this case, I'm not going to actually use this file for the moment. That's only in case of an emergency. But I had to use a second SD card because it would not load. So what we're going to do is go over to the actual desk, pop out the actual drive. We're then going to place it inside here when the power's off. So I have to de-energize the system here. So I've just removed the plug for the power. Now I'm going to place this in here and you'll see it flash to actually load your firmware. So there'll be a little light over on the left hand side right in here someplace. So let me plug this in. You can see that it's flashing. It's already completed. So now what we can do is we can actually see if it's booting and go from there. So as you can see, it is booting like it did before in the previous tutorial. So when this comes up, we can actually log into it using the actual web browser. So it'll be the same address of 192.168.1.7 per my configuration. Yours may be different depending upon your router. So let me minimize and go over to the desktop, open a browser window, do 192.168.1.7, hit enter. Should come up with an issue over here. So what we currently have an issue with is the firmware. So we're actually going to have to go back into TeraTerm. This might take a second to bring up. Let me make this bigger so you can see it. So let's reconnect, continue, and what we're going to do is BIQU for the username, BIQU for the passphrase or password, and click OK. Remember, we're using Secure Shell or SHA to connect to this. So what we're going to have to do now is actually find the actual configuration. And so if we go back over to the directions for Klipper, you can see down here we're going to have to use the ls to find it. So what we can then do is go over here, right click, paste it, hit enter, and we can see the actual processor. But in order to set this up, we're going to have to set it up with the actual file. So we'll go back over here to the file using this, and we'll cheat. So we're going to find the configuration. First thing that we need to do is find what it's called. So this is the one that we're going to use. I'm actually going to copy the file name and create it over in the other file. So I'm going to copy, go over here, go to, I believe, machine. We're going to create a file. So create, the file name is going to be this. So I've already created this previously, so it already exists, but I'm showing you at least so you'll understand. So I'm going to cancel, and I also probably already populated this up here and then move the MCU from down below, which is located down here, to the top of the file just for convenience. So the reason I did that is so I can actually replace the actual name easier. So if I click over here, I can right click, copy this. Whoop. Sorry, let me do this again. Highlight it, right click, and it's now copied. So then we can go over here, and let's see if it's different from the one that I currently have in here, because it might be the same. So serial colon, then right click and paste, and you can see that it's different. So let's take this line out, and let's save and restart. So now let's go back over here and see what happened. We should have another error. Right now, what the issue is that we don't have the actual ADC power range set correctly. And what that is basically saying is you don't have thermistors. So in this case, I would have to add two thermistors. So let me grab two. And I'm going to see if we can get away with it just by plugging them in. But I'm going to have to look to see where they're connected. So first thing that we're going to do is we're going to go over here. We're going to go back. We're going to find the actual hardware. And then we're going to find the, let's see if it's here. This might not be helpful. Sorry. It's actually probably this. So we're going to look for TH and TH bed. So you can see them right here. So we have thermal hot end 0 and thermal hot end 1. So these two need to be connected. So let's go over to the desktop and see if we can do this. Normally I would do this with the power off, but in this case I'm just going to show you real quick. So that's 1. And then the second one's over here. Now normally this would be your normal thermistors, depending upon your configuration, but I'm showing you just to stub it out on the desk so you can see what's occurring. So let's go back over and see if we can get away with it on the actual interface. So if we click over here and we do a restart, we may have to restart firmware or a reboot, but let's see what happens. Okay, so it can't find the configuration, so we'll try a restart firmware. This may take a little bit longer. So it looks like it came up and there's no issue. We can actually test this by actually going over and doing both. But currently, let me see if I can do the camera on the desktop real quick here. So if you're watching over in here where you see the actual heat, I'm going to grab one of these and put my fingers on it and watch the temperature go up. So it's my body heat's driving it up so that we can actually test it. So that's how you can test your thermistor. Usually you want to do that with the power off if you can connect to the board. But in this case, I just wanted to show you what was occurring. So at this point, I'd like to thank my patrons, the people that do buy me a cup of coffee, the people on PayPal, and all your support on YouTube. And everyone, take care, be safe, and I'll talk to you in the next one.